let me first make an introduction of both sides. So this is a regular undergraduate third year class that I teach in this slot, right? They happen to be third year students of the Department of Mechanical Engineering, and we teach them a course on electronics. To the third year students of this class, we have several teachers, several professors from other universities here, and they are trying to see how our class is conducted, how we carry out assignments and presentations at IIT Bombay. And the objective of this session is to introduce the idea of student participation and student presentation, and to give a feel of that as we have at IIT Bombay, right? Let me give a brief background to the theme that we are going to look at today. You see, these students have been given an assignment pertaining to exploring applications of electronics in their field. So, you see, the whole objective here is that teaching has two components in it. I mean, one part is what you call formal instruction that we see all the time. I'm sure professors from other universities have a lot of exposure to that dimension of teaching. There is another dimension which we call cooperative learning, okay, which formally is called cooperative learning, that relates to bringing students together to do some self-exploration. You know, incidentally, if one looks at the word education, it comes from two roots, Latin roots, ex and ducare, which really means to bring out. Ex means outwards, it really means to bring out, I mean, in short. So, if, and even if one looks at the way, you know, education is described either in the ancient Western system or in the ancient Indian system, there is an emphasis on recognizing that there is potential within the student and letting it flower. So, very seldom does one think of education. I mean, the great masters in education or in teaching have always regarded education as a process of letting a plant bloom, something similar. So, you know, when you want a plant to grow, you don't paste leaves on it. You water it, you give it sunshine, you give it, you know, the soil in which it can flourish, and the plant grows from a seed. So, it's within, it comes without. That's education. Now, the same thing holds for, that's a part of education. You see, of course, when you want to grow a plant, there's always this requirement that you at times need to prune, at times you need to specifically grow some parts or encourage some specific stems to grow and so on, to nurture. So, nurture is an important part of education, nurturing the talent within. So, although formal instruction is a very important part of education, the dimension of nourishment, of nurturing, of allowing sunshine in which the potential within can come without is a very important part of education. And very often assignments given to a class or opportunities given to the student community to carry out relatively open-ended projects are a step in that direction. So, let me introduce the specific theme that we have today. Well, these students were asked to explore the applications of electronics and electrical engineering in mechanical engineering. Their basic discipline is mechanical engineering, and they were asked to explore the applications of electronics and electrical engineering in mechanical engineering, either directly or indirectly. I mean, it doesn't have to specifically relate to a device in mechanical engineering, but it could relate to ideas that are useful in mechanical engineering, or it could relate to what mechanical engineers need to use. That was the theme behind it. And what we've done today is to select a few groups who have come well prepared with a presentation to talk about what they have surveyed, researched, and presented here. We'll first have them present, and then afterwards we'll discuss some of the aspects of the presentation, some of the finer points and so on, right? So, I'll first invite the group to make their presentation.
Respected teachers and my dear friends, myself Rohit Vadeda, my friends are Aditya Kate, he and KNB Teja. So, here we have done a presentation about anti-lock braking system for this course. And as you might be aware, this anti-lock braking system is a mechatronic application in which the motor vehicles steerability as well as the stability control. These are to be required to be controlled. So the basic purpose of the ABS is to maintain the stability and controllability of the overall steering system. And the main aspect of this is that whenever the control unit of the car discovers that either of the particular wheel under consideration is moving very slow, considering its translation velocity is very low compared to other wheels. So in such cases, the system stops such wheels, stops applying brake on that wheel so that it regains its speed, and the overall translation velocity is same for each individual wheel. So it helps in maintaining the constant speed. So as we have shown in the next diagram, this is a basic scheme of the system. As you might see over there, that there are four wheels we have shown. Each wheel is connected to one sensor, and there are four control valves, each for one wheel. And there is one electronic control unit. And there is also one pump and a master cylinder, which controls all the fluid. So now my friend will take over and explain you a bit more about this mechanical parts first. And then we will carry over to electronics.
The master cylinder converts the force supplied by the brake booster and the pedal into the hydraulic pressure of the brake fluid. And the brake booster basically increases the force supplied by the pedal. And brake fluid, it is used to to apply the pressure, and it is designed to operate at high temperatures. It has low melting point and high boiling point, and control valve is used to control the amount of fluid flowing to the brakes. It acts as the valve, and it's controlled by the electronic control unit. And fluid reservoir stores the working fluid, which is the brake fluid, then pump. And here we use the pulse width modulated pump, and it acts as the pressure booster. Basically increases the pressure of the brake fluid. Then vehicle speed sensor, it is made up of a toothed disc, and it is mounted on a shaft. And also there is a magnetic coil, and a stationary detector is mounted on the magnetic coil. The detector sends electrical pulses to the computer, and these are generated through the magnet. And as the vehicle speed increases, the frequency of the pulses also increases.
This is a typical circuit diagram of the anti-lock braking system. These orange ones are the sensor attached to front wheel, and these are sensor attached to rear wheel. This IC LM290 are sensor conditioning comparators, which compare the input to output of the sensors and give the their output to this CPU microcontroller, blue one, whose IC number is HPC16083. Then the green one is the voltage regulator. It is a low dropout voltage regulator with a delayed reset, and the delayed reset is given by a delayed capacitor. This LM1956 is a solenoid driver smart power, and the three ICs which are in the bottom of the circuit are used basically for the fail-safe purpose. This is another compressor microcontroller, COP8640, and the ICs LM1921 and 1951 are used for lamp drivers and relay drivers respectively. The basic function of CPU microcontroller, HPC16083 is the main driver of this whole anti-lock braking system. It has a multiply and divide instruction cycle time of 7 milliseconds. Then it provides the necessary input capture registers and PMW timers to drive the four wheel and four channel anti-lock braking system. We are not going into pretty details of the circuit diagram of the compressor microcontroller, but the basic function of the compressor microcontroller is to dealing with the fault tolerance and diagnostics. Now, sensor conditioning comparators. These are the comparators which compare the sensor outputs given by each rear wheel and front wheel. And the good feature of this is that they can be driven from a single power supply, and a split power supply can also be used for driving them. Another IC is voltage regulator, which was connected. Unregulated battery input is given to this voltage regulator. It is a voltage, low dropout voltage regulator with a delayed reset, and that delayed reset is given by the delay capacitor, which is as shown in the pin 4 of the circuit diagram. The another safety component, lamp driver high side switch, LM1921, is the uses P as a PNP transistor as a main driving component. Then the good thing with this is it has a very large range of output voltage, so that your system works safely for most of the cases. But in case of any failure, the output can swing below the ground potential, below 57 volts, negative with respect to the power supply. These LM1951 are relay drivers high side switch. These are mainly used for this failure purposes. If there is some failure, like open load or short circuit or thermal breakdown, or currently if the circuit current limit increases or voltage, or there is over voltage, then as shown in this output 4 is error flag. It sends error flag output back to the compressor microcontroller, and it can then process the necessary so that the system works properly. The conclusion is that this anti-lock braking system is a very user-friendly active safety device, and the vehicles which are not having ABS present in them have to pump their brakes manually. When the ABS system is applied to the vehicle, then this is automatically pumping the brakes out. And the main precaution to be taken by driver is that to apply continuous force on the brake pedal so that the ABS system works properly. Let me mention about the references. We have taken the IC diagrams and pin configuration diagrams from National Semiconductor's website, and we have taken the help of the mathsworks.com for the simulation purpose. That's all with the presentation. Thank you.
So that was a very nice presentation from the first group. Now we'll make some observations about the presentation, and of course definitely some positive things. I mean, I could see that the students have made a very good study, a very good survey of the problem. They have explained the context in which this braking system is important. They have been able to highlight both the mechanical and the electronic importance of the application. And they've also been able to show some results on simulation, which explain the behavior of the control system as a function of time, right? So it's a very good presentation. Now let's see if we have any questions. So I think, you know, that's also a part of the learning process. So you've listened to a presentation. Now the other colleagues in the class might have questions. So even anybody else who's listened to the presentation might have questions. Now I must mention one important virtue of a good presentation is the number of questions it generates, right? I mean, the more the curiosity that you arouse, the more successful you should think your presentation has been. Are there any questions that you might want to put? All right, so that I think we could certainly have more questions. I see there are more questions, but let's have another presentation now, right? Now you have another presentation on the braking system. What I suggest you do is to come and only add to what has been said, right? In a couple of minutes. Yeah, the second present, now they have a complement to this. Let's take the other ones first, right? If you don't mind, so that we have different aspects explored. So now we have other themes also having been explored. So let's...
Good morning, everybody. We are going to have a presentation on a mechatronics product that's not been implemented in India till now, and that's called the automated railway crossing system. Basically, on the level crossings, many of the level crossings out here in India are unmanned. And that's a concern because, as you can see, there are so many unmanned railway crossings out here. So many accidents happen, and the number of accidents increasing is a matter of concern out here. So that's the reason why we chose this topic. And that's the thing. What we are going to do is to present us a concept that would help us to implement something that so that the doors automatically gets closed whenever the train approaches the crossing. So that's our basic working principle. We'll sense the train approaching. We'll use the sense signal as the input. Out here, I need to make a point. The signal we are using is the train signal. The trains have red and green light out there for the train motion. As soon as it's green, it would go, otherwise red, it's obvious. So what we are going to do is, as soon as the light turns red or green, we are going to sense that signal. And we are going to input the signal to the DC. We are going to use this input to drive a DC motor using a H-bridge. It's cost-effective because all the components are transistors and all that are very cheap as compared to the other things what we would be presenting. And it's safer because there are zero chances of human error, and it can be controlled straight away from where the signals are controlled. So that's it. Thank you.
So that was a very good presentation. You noticed that the students actually explained the working mechanism. You know, they related the components that they had studied, transistors, MOSFETs, and so on. They related those components to a specific practical requirement of wanting to, you know, drive a motor in one direction or the other. And they also, so therefore, there is an electromechanical aspect to it. It's a very interesting presentation. We can take maybe one question about. So what I would particularly like the participants of the course to pay attention to, and of course the class as well, is not only the question, but how questions get generated, right, in the mind of an audience.